chronic total occlusion percutaneous coronary interventions are becoming increasingly popular amongst interventional cardiologists due to the recently increasing success rates and decreasing complication rates. In the ensuing slides, we'll present a few basic tips and tricks on how to start and establish a successful CTO-PCI program. The goal of such a program is to safely and efficiently and effectively recanalize chronic total occlusions in patients who have the appropriate clinical indication. To do this, it is important to address several components, starting first with the operator. Education is key for performing CTO interventions, which are actually not necessarily an extension of the non-CTO interventions. There is an entirely different nomenclature, entirely different techniques and equipment. So one can start by familiarizing with the terminology and the techniques by reading books such as the Manual of CTO Interventions, with which obviously I have a conflict, and also looking at websites such as the ctofundamentals.org, a website that presents both didactic component as well as forms a platform for sharing cases with other CTO operators. The next component is to perform to actually watch procedures in live courses. This is an example of such a course from several years ago from Bellingham in Seattle. This is a unique forum that not only lets you appreciate troubleshooting of cases as well as exchange opinions with other experienced operators and really get motivated and started on doing these programs. And this is followed by proctoring of cases in your laboratory. CTO interventions can be tricky, and having someone walk you through the initial steps of, for example, a retrograde procedure or an undergrade dissection reentry procedure can be a very effective way of getting the skills established with less stress and safer and better outcomes. And last but not least, one can proceed to share those experiences and teach others how to do this through online forums. So one such forum is the VA CTO Glab, that forms such a forum for the VA operators. It is important for the operator starting a CTO program to be focused on CTO rather than focus on other areas such as congenital, peripheral, and structural, given the time and the energy and the effort it requires, especially at the early stages, to establish a good and solid CTO program. Moving on to the cath lab, another critical component of success, since everything we do doesn't happen in isolation, but happens as part of a team. We start by developing a CTO card, which is an area where all the CTO equipment is gathered. Wires, microcatheters, equipment for managing complications. Having everything in one location can really help expedite the procedure and avoid delays. It is important to educate the cath lab staff on the basics of CTO intervention, for example, the usual use of bifemoral access, the importance of dual injection, the use of heparin, and the monitoring required with ACTs every 30 minutes, and the goals of 300 or more for undergrade and 350 or more for retrograde, as well as radiation and the importance to be vigilant and ready to manage any potential complications. Radiation exposure is a very special risk for CTO interventions that can be minimized by using low-frame fluoroscopy, using the fluorostore function, and being very vigilant on how much radiation the patient has received in order to avoid going past 6 or 7 or 8 gray and increasing the risk of radiation skin injury. This can all be accomplished by scheduling CTO patients in specific CTO days that allows uninterrupted attention of the operator in doing those cases without having other cases to deal with. So one can focus exclusively on doing the CTO cases, taking as long as it takes, which especially in the early days can be a little more lengthy than later on. To have a successful program, it is critical to gain support from administration. And this requires an explanation to them about the benefits of CTO intervention, both for the patient, but as well as for the institution. A common concern that administrators have is about procedural cost. And it is true that CTO interventions do have higher cost than non-CTO interventions, requiring more guide wires, more balloons, and more stents. However, in a study from Dimitri Carbagliotti from Piedmont, now in Colombia, showed that actually the contribution margin was similar for CTO and non-CTO interventions, showing that actually CTO interventions can be a non-money losing proposition for a hospital and actually can provide profit. And not only that, but this is a great example of the halo effect. Having an institution that does very good CTO interventions makes people perceive it as being very good at other interventions as well, and as a result, help them receive referrals from other hospitals for many other types of complex coronary and other interventions. And last but not least, it is important to educate the patients as well as the referring physicians. Having referrals means that the patients and the physicians understand what to expect from a CTO intervention, and that can be achieved by sharing your successes and also taking a conservative approach by having initial time to mature the program before becoming more avid proponents. So initially one needs to start slow, gain the confidence and the high success rates, and then expand and advertise the program and gain more referrals for the more complex cases, which invariably are going to follow. So in summary, building a CTO program is feasible, but it's best achieved with a systematic, methodical, and slow approach, targeting all four elements of operator education, cath lab education, gaining support from administration, and educating the patients and the referring physicians. This can provide a tremendous opportunity for the operator to grow and become better in these complex procedures, and can have significant benefits for the patients as well as for the operators.